People think architects are not business people. They're wrong. Architects are so creative, they can turn business people inside out.
Business of Architecture, episode 280. Hello, Architect Nation. I'm Enoch Sears, and this is the show where you'll discover tips, strategies, and secrets for growing an impactful and profitable architecture practice. Today, we welcome back architect Nick Santakis to the show. Nick runs a successful residential architectural practice based in Scottsdale, Arizona. His impressive work is frequently published in local and national media. In today's episode, you'll discover the surprising method Nick has discovered for reaching his ideal clients. You're really going to get a lot out of this. You'll discover how collaborating with your competitors can actually help you grow your practice, and tips for getting your work published. Indeed, even taking the power into your own hands and self-publishing and how that works. Now, if you haven't already, get free instant access to the 4-part Architecture Firm Profit Map video for firm owners by going to freearchitectgift.com. Enter your best email address on that page and you'll get instant access. Before we jump into today's episode, I wanted to give a shout out to some co-podcast hosts, David Lee and Marina Berderine. They host the Midnight Charrette podcast, which in their own words is an explicit podcast about design, architecture, and people, but be warned, it's often not safe for work, close quote. Well, that's true. It also is not all the time safe for young ears. I know David and Marina personally, as they've attended a couple of my seminars. Listening to David and Marina reminds me of those late night conversations hanging out in studio. If you're looking for witty insider commentary that is times both thought-provoking and disturbing, and at other times lighthearted and entertaining, check out the Midnight Charrette in your favorite podcast app today. Today's episode is sponsored by Gusto. Gusto makes managing payroll simple. One of the firm leaders in my Architect CEO program said that Gusto has been a game changer for his business, allowing him to have big firm tools, even though he has just a few employees. Running your payroll with Gusto takes 7 minutes on average. You can also add benefits and HR support to take care of your team and keep your business safe. As a podcast listener, you can get 3 free months when you run your first payroll. Just go to gusto.com/BOA to get your 3 free months and support the show. Now with that, let's dive in to today's episode. So Nick, you get a lot of work of your work from word of mouth, as you described. What did you do, because you moved to Arizona mid-career, I'll say. At that time, you probably didn't have much word of mouth in Arizona. So how did you get work during those early days? What lessons can you share with us about being able to quickly build to the point where you're doing fulfilling work, the kind of products you want to be working on?
Well, when I arrived here 24 years ago, I was already 40 and I had practiced for 15 years in Montreal. And I came to Arizona for political reasons. I decided to move my family. So I decided mentally that no matter what was going to happen, my future was going to be here. So initially, being a Canadian and so on, I had to figure out ways, first of all, to be able to have working status and so on over here, and I get the proper visas and so on. So I was I had to keep my Canadian office open and my American office operating at the same time till I got my green card, which took about 6 years. So in the meantime, I wasn't looking for instantly getting the clients that I thought I deserved at the time, because I had a reputation back in Canada and so on. Nobody here knew me. So it didn't make a difference to them, and they were very busy in the mid-90s. To them, I was just somebody who may be here temporarily or not. They didn't really pay much attention. So I was able to find work by just doing things that people did not want to do here, like, for example, working with builders who had in-house drafting, and their drafting department didn't want to bother with clients who wanted to make changes to their products, which were not their models. So I facilitated doing drawings for their salespeople so I can give them back to their drafting department so they can draw up the modified versions of their models. After doing that for a bit, then they decided, well, why don't you do all the drawings of the models and, you know, with your people? And we did that. So for the first 7 years, we were a drafting service for builders. and hoping to meet clients and so on out there. And eventually, it led to the first major client that was going to allow me to basically do something that I was capable of, something different. And that's what led to my first project. But it was a 7 to 8 year process by the time that happened. But in the meantime, regardless of what I was able to do, it didn't matter to anybody. They didn't care if I was well known in Canada and I had a great practice and so on. I had great projects. To them, I was just another guy. So I decided to, okay, when I finished that project, then I had to get my message out to the general public so that more and more people can see my work, now that I can finally have something that I could photograph and send out. And I did send out this is funny how it started. One of my clients that I had done some work for the semi-custom home for a builder was starting a postcard company, and he said, hey, Nick, you know, the house you just finished, why don't you take a picture of it and send it, put it in this postcard pack, and we'll send it to 50,000 homes. I said, you know, I don't know if architects are allowed to advertise here, because in Canada we're not. So let me check into it, and I'll get back to you. And I got back to him and said, look, there's nothing against advertising for architects. So what I did is I said, look, I'm going to take a picture of this home and take this $3,500, but it's like I'm throwing it in the garbage, and I'm supporting you because you supported me as a client, as my client. But I don't believe anybody's going to order architecture from a postcard. And So I did that reluctantly. I said, look, I may be a laughingstock. Then I thought, wait a second, nobody knows who I am here in Arizona. So what I did is I went ahead with that, and the first mailing was going out on a Thursday. By Thursday at lunchtime, I had my first call from an attorney. He said, you're the architect we're looking for. And I called my client, and I said, you know, Ray, you're not going to believe this. I already have an appointment for Saturday, and the poster just went out this morning. And then I started getting these phone calls. I started getting phone calls from the Arizona Republic, which is a local paper. They wanted to do a story on that house, and it went on Cool Homes. And I got called by a local magazine, and I thought they wanted to do a story on the house. I said, no, that house has already been published. I said, what, a Saturday in the paper? That's it? I spent 8 years doing a project. It finally got some attention, and now could not even be exposed anymore, because that's their policy. They do only original homes. So, you know, I said, you know, this is crazy. I continued with the postcards, and I kept getting, I grew to an office of 15 people. I was doing over 40 jobs a year. It was insane that this marketing that went directly to the public was leading to constant phone calls and meetings and so on. And so what happened was, you know, I thought to myself, you know, I got a phone call from one person who was starting a magazine and asked me, well, you know, we'd like to put that photograph of your home on the postcard on the front cover of our magazine. I said, wow, well, what is that going to cost? They said nothing. I said, well, sure, of course, go ahead. So I kept getting, this magazine started growing, and I had like 4 covers in that over the next year, 2 years, and I got covers on other magazines with other projects. And then I decided, you know what, those magazines closed because it was very difficult for them to survive, and I decided to start my own publication. And that's what I did. I figured, you know, I'm going to be in the front cover, the back cover, and everywhere in between. I had to figure out a way to get people to pay or subsidize part of the cost. And those were the people that were working on my projects. And I did take out full-page ads, and we'd send them out to 50,000 homes in the Phoenix area. And that's how my publishing started.
But very, very, all very of a sudden interesting. With the recession. Yeah. So we're going to dive into that in our next interview, but I'm glad we got to talk a lot about the business development. Thanks for sharing your story about growing the practice, Nick.
Thank you, Enoch.
Yep. So at the end of last episode, you were telling us about the evolution in your story where you discovered this very interesting way and the power of going direct to the public.
Right.
So tell me about that, and how has that influenced what you're doing today? Let's dive into that story.
Well, as I was mentioning in the previous episode, I was very very taken by the fact that by going directly to the general public with your print information, that people would respond to the to the architecture, and it led to quite a bit of work for us, and a lot of independence actually. So I had publications coming out every year, going to 50,000 homes of with our own work, and as I mentioned earlier, it was paid for partially by advertisers that were taking out full page ads in the magazine, and these were trades and people that were working on our projects. With the recession of 2007-2008, decided to stop that because nothing was happening out there. And then for a couple of years, I thought, you know, I really liked the fact that having a publication going to the public was great, but why don't I get together with about a dozen or 15 of my colleagues and do a magazine like that with all of us. This way it will generate even more interest, and what we can do is provide networking events with the people that are sponsoring the magazine, that are taking out full page ads. So I made a list of 15 firms that are colleagues and competitors of mine, went to meet them one at a time, and even they knew that I had already my own publication, because I was this guy from Canada that came out in the middle of nowhere and all of a sudden was known and getting work around the valley. So they knew that it wasn't something that it was a dream of mine. It was something that I actually had done on my own, and I was going to do it as a group. So we formed Arizona Residential Architects. We're 15 firms, and we met, and within 2 months, we had 89 trade partners, and we had the magazine out to 31,000 homes. And also had our first networking event with the trade partners in the magazine and the architects. Every 2 months we have a networking event with the trade partners. So that's 6 times a year. We used to have a 7th event, which was a holiday party, which we don't have anymore, because that was a lot of work as well with our, you know, it was sponsored with our interior designers and so on. So we have been now in business for 9 years, and not only that, we have 140 trade partners, and we have a waiting list of people wanting to get in. Into the networking group and so on. To us, we are not a publication. We are a networking group. Yet, as a publication for the architects, we each have 4 pages in the magazine. We go out to 30,000 homes every 6 months, and people are constantly getting our images. They're getting it for free at their homes, and they're understanding that architects can design very livable, well-designed homes, and not necessarily having to spend more money. It's just the way that these projects are being directed by someone, and that some person is the architect, and that's the message we send to people. Also, in the inside cover of each magazine, the front cover, there's the 10 reasons to hire an architect, which is extremely important because people don't know what we actually do. So these are bullet points of what an architect can do for you, and we start each publication that way. In the meantime, we have all these trade partners and then networking, and now we have national and international trade partners are part of our group, because when they come in to a networking event, they can schedule it so that when they fly in from Canada or from Europe and so on, or from other parts of the United States, they can come into a networking event where they have about 150 to 250 people at one time and meet face-to-face and then build relationships that way and set up meetings and so on. So it's a very valuable resource for trade partners as builders, interior designers, tradespeople, realtors, bankers, and so on, to meet with the architects. And it's been working extremely well.
Hey, Architect Nation, real fast, I want to draw your attention to May 1st through the 3rd, 2019. I'm hosting the Architect Business Summit in Chicago, Illinois, and I would love to meet you there in person. During these 3 days, some of the most successful architects I've had the pleasure of working with will pull back the curtain to reveal what they're doing to grow their income, freedom, and impact as firm owners. This will be the must-attend event for architecture firm owners in 2019. You won't want to miss this. Go to businessofarchitecture.com/live to get information on who will be speaking and find out how to grab your ticket. What does it take to actually put together a publication? I mean, there's layout, you have to find a print shop, you got to have editorial overview to make sure that the grammar and the spelling is correct. You know, what really does it take to put something like that together?
Well, first, you need a sales force, which is to get the advertisers. And the sales force are the 15 architectural firms that have contacts with various people in the design and construction industry. So we are the sales force. And secondly, of course, you need to do the graphic layouts of the magazine, and my son Nicholas does the graphic design for each magazine, and along with me, we do the editing and so on. We don't have the content that we have is generally written by either our sponsors. We used to have a full page editorials by the sponsors that would be side to side with our ad, and they would get that for free. And many times we do, some of the sponsors, they actually underwrite stories that are done by writers out there and that are put in the publication at their cost, but not to us. And then when it comes to the printing and so on, we have a very high quality magazine. It's 212 pages, including the covers. But we have been looking and eventually found the right type of printers that can do a consistent, high quality product for us all the time. It's a very complicated process, but it gets more complicated if you have too many people involved. And because we are, you know, I as the publisher, my son as the graphics designer, the architects as a sales force, and so on, we limit our expenses and basically put all the quality and the profit we have into the quality of the magazine. And we have also the lowest cost per full-page ad at $1,500. Because we can afford to do so. And as I said before, we are a networking group. We're not a publication, yet we're a very successful publication because we give people other things than they would get normally out of just a regular magazine. I don't know if I explained everything to you. It's a very complex process, but it takes many years of working through meeting the right people, printers, there's mailing involved and so on. It's a six-figure expense to come up with a magazine that we have. And that expense is basically taken care of by the sponsors that are part of the magazine. And they're in the magazine because they network with the architectural firms. And that's why they want to be there. They're not as interested necessarily to getting into people's homes with an ad. They're more interested in getting to the architects. But in the meantime, they also get calls from the public because these companies, they're all vetted. They are companies that have great service, quality, and so on. Otherwise, it would not be in the publication. They get calls also and are identified by the public. We're talking about national companies and local companies that have great reputations.
So, Nick, what you're looking at taking this to the next level. Tell me about that.
Well, you know, for years, many people have asked me, you know, why don't we have an ARA in our state and so on. And I've tried. And I tried to in Nevada, in California, and even in Tucson, which is, you know, just south of the Phoenix area. And what I found was that the architects could not find a group of architects. And I need a minimum of 8 to get together to actually agree to do something like this. So I thought to myself, I was very discouraged because architects themselves would not want to get together. And meanwhile, I was very fortunate that we had 15 firms that were at the right place at the right time, and they were the right people. We get along extremely well, and we make every decision unanimously. And I found that it was not something that could be replicated. So what I finally came to me that over the last 7 years, because I was trying to expand this on a national level, was that why don't because our trade partners are interested in meeting the architects, but yet the architects have no way of organizing themselves. And I thought, why don't I do the following? I came up with a publication called NARAN, North American Residential Architects Network. And it's something that just happened very recently over the last couple of months. And today, it's actually starting my meeting right after this is to the first group of architects that will be presented the new magazine. And I thought, okay, I split the country into 10 different regions of roughly because about 10,000 licensed architects in each one, California being region number one. Number two is the six Western Mountain states and the four Northwest states. Number three is Texas and so on. And then I figured the way that I'm going to attract the architects to be in this publication is to have someone pay for their ads, and then which would be taken care of from the trade partner. So a trade partner can select an architect, and they will pay for a full page ad and gift a 2-page spread to an architectural firm. And so it would encourage getting the architect to connect with the trade partner, and then this way would be able to have a publication that would again send 10,000 units, magazines, to the top evaluated homes in that region. So there's something there for everyone, where the architects get this free publicity in digital and in print form, and basically paid for by the trade partner, so that there's an encouragement to connect and network with somebody like a window manufacturer and so on that you may not know, but at the same time being gifted a 2-page ad brings you, either you've worked together on projects or brings you closer together. And at the same time, if an architect does not want to deal with a trade partner, but they want to be into the 10,000 circulation that we have, what they could do is buy a page for $750 or buy multiple pages as they want. They send in their images of projects, up to 4 images per home, and they may or may not be published depending on the quality of the work as well. So we will scrutinize the level of architecture that is suitable. It has to be done by licensed architects and has to be completed work in that particular region. And by doing this, sending that then to 10,000 top evaluated homes, it will again connect more people in the country with architects from their region. And then I also, all the architects in every region would be receiving this publication that, let's say, people from California are sending out. Everybody that had participated in other regions, for example, region number 2 and number 3, those architects will receive and know and find out what the architects in California are doing, and so on. So I'm trying to create this network of architects sending in their work. They can get published free of charge. The sponsors or trade partners will be able to pay for their ads if they like, and create also a working relationship with these firms. And if they don't, then they could select another firm. They can select multiple firms, and so on. And then sending it to the general public to really acquaint them more with what architects are doing in their region. And every publication obviously would be different, so that when a client receives that in their home, they would be able to 6 months later when they get the next one, because it's the biannual publication, they would see that it's a different. Different homes in it, and so on, and they would be able to take a look at it and start collecting these magazines, and then also refer to them digitally as well. I think it's a way of getting the architects and the sponsors together, and then connecting them with the general public. I hope that it works. I really feel that if the architects are enthusiastic about it and start sending in their work, that it will, because if they don't, well, their other colleagues and competitors will. Somebody's going to do it. If you're going to be offered free marketing of 2 pages that you do not have to pay for, are you going to do it? It costs you nothing to expose it to 10,000 people, and that's what I think is going to make it successful. But it's a long, long road to get there. You can imagine I have contacts with architects in all states. They all get our ARM publication. They all would like to have something like that in their states, but we can't do it. But NARAN will be something that they all can participate in and immediately be able to start. And I only need about 30 trade partners per magazine, and then the maximum would be about 70. So the magazine can fluctuate from 100 pages to 212 pages, and the public will be getting it free of charge. And the architects will be getting free marketing. And there's nothing wrong. You cannot be overexposed. People don't, in our business, need to understand that. It's good to have new and rare images, but if people don't see your work, they will not know what you're all about.
Nick, what if someone's listening to this and they'd like to get involved, how do they go about doing that?
What they can do is is they could email me at Nickt, N-I-C-K-T, at Naran, N-A-R-A-N, dot pub. Or they could email me at info@ArizonaResidentialArchitects.com. And they can also call, which is, I'll be happy to talk with them, at 480-874-2288.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Nick, for sharing this amazing, interesting model that you've built both for your practice and then also the publishing. So we look forward to seeing where it goes in the future.
Thank you, Enoch. I'm glad to talk to you.
And that's a wrap. To discover more about the process for creating a better firm with less fires and more fun, go to businessofarchitecture.com/freedomwebinar. On that page, you'll be able to sign up for a free 90-minute online training on how to create a firm that empowers your staff and is set to grow and scale without chaining you to your desk. Discover how to market your firm to win better projects. Sign up for my next free design firm marketing training at architectwebinar.com. That is a free online presentation. You can watch it from the comfort of your home or office anywhere that you are in the world. Today's podcast episode is sponsored by Gusto. Gusto makes managing your payroll simple. It's designed specifically for small business owners. One of the firm leaders in my Architect CEO program said that Gusto has been a game changer for his business, allowing him to have big firm tools even though he has just a few employees. Running your payroll with Gusto takes approximately 7 minutes. You can also add benefits and HR support to take care of your team and keep your business safe. As a podcast listener, you can get 3 free months of payroll when you run your first payroll. Go to gusto.com/BOA to get your 3 free months and support the show. The views expressed on this show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment except to help you conquer the world. Carpe diem.